Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please welcome on stage Mr. James Whale. Ah, yes. Well, thank you very much indeed. That's because, you know, I've been doing a few of these, in fact, I think you can see one of them on our website, the award ceremonies. And I did one last week where I was just the voice saying things like, ladies and gentlemen, please would you welcome on stage Mr. So-and-so-and-so-and-so. So I got a bit carried away with that, really, but still quite nice. Rob's here. Where's Rob?
I'm here. I'm still, yes, over here, waving at you.
Oh, yeah, good, fine. I just thought you might have forgotten to turn up for the show, that's all.
I'd never do that.
No, of course you wouldn't, of course you wouldn't. So, here we are on the James Whale Radio Show, broadcast across the universe by satellite, I suppose. Does the World Wide Web work on satellite?
Part of it does, yes.
Yeah. We're, of course, across all kinds of formats. We're on radio stations, we're online, and wherever you happen to be listening to us, welcome to the program. And, of course, as this is downloaded by many people at many different times of the day, very good night to you, a very good morning, a very good afternoon, and a very good day. So it's lovely to have you with us. So what is this? Well, it's an hour or so of me talking bollocks, to be quite honest with you, one way or the other. My thoughts on what's happening in the world, as I have done for the past 40-odd years. A bit of music. Got some great music on the programme today. Carol Decker has given us an exclusive of her new single. So that's good. How did you manage that? Did you flirt with her?
I would never do such a thing. I just asked nicely.
Did you? Oh, it must have been me flirting then, mustn't it?
I'm not saying a thing.
No, I wouldn't if I were you. So anyway, what else have we got to... I tell you what, I'm going to be talking to one of my old mates. Do you remember Mr. Paparazzi, Darryn Lyons? Often on TV with me, we did all sorts of things. He came up with this idea where people who had mobile phones and were in a restaurant or in public and they saw somebody famous doing something that maybe they shouldn't have, or they saw a news item unfold in front of them, he acted as a sort of agent to get their photographs into the newspapers, onto the television, stuff like that. And he ran a very successful PR company and was all around entertaining bloke, to be honest. If you look on the website, you will recognise him. Well, I'm going to be talking to him, Darryn Lyons, who now has a completely different job. But stay tuned to find out what it is. All I would say is, Boris Johnson, you had better look out, baby. Right, now, I'm glad that's all happened. So what are we doing now?
My toilet seat was the wrong colour.
Oh, yeah, what are you tweeting me pictures of your bog seed for?
I'm just showing you it arrived, but it's the wrong colour.
Well, who apart from your big fat arse is going to see it anyway?
The dog.
You don't take a dog to the toilet.
The dog sits by my feet whilst I perch.
Oh, disgusting. Did you know it's recently been, I was talking about it on other radio programmes, it's been World Toilet Day.
So there we go. So now I've ruined it by not having the right colour.
Well, no, it's interesting. I mean, you talk about toilets as far as you're concerned in your private little boudoir with your comfortable, probably knowing you, you've probably got a heated toilet seat as well. But the vast majority of the people who inhabit this planet do not have very good toilet facilities at all.
You mean as in just a hole in the ground?
And sometimes it is a communal hole in the ground.
Right, a bit like I'm a Celebrity.
Well, no, they don't go in together. They go in one at a time. But I mean, I have to admit, I've not been watching that. The idea of seeing some of the people who are in there puts me off.
One of them walked out.
Yeah, the fat lass. Yeah, she's gone, hasn't she?
Mm.
You're not supposed to say that, are you? The weight in weight. I don't know. What's still the word for fat?
Large.
Lardy.
You're going to get us into trouble.
Why?
You can't say things like that.
No?
No, well, I don't mind, but, you know, I'm sure the PC brigade will complain.
Well, probably, but apparently people have been rude about her size on Twitter. Now, I haven't read anything, I don't know. But hang on, this is a woman who's made an enormous amount of money out of being in the public eye. Promoting the fact that she is big. I think, hasn't she got a fashion house for big women or something like that, or a fashion label? I don't know. And she decides to sign up for money to go into the jungle where, listen, I wouldn't go in. I would not inflict my body on other people. Well, apart from Mrs. W, and she says I don't inflict it on her enough. So that's another story. Anyway, I would not go into the jungle. And if I did, it would be for copious amounts of cash. And whatever anybody said, you fat bastard or whatever else, quite frankly, it wouldn't worry me because that's what happens. And just to walk out, well, quite frankly, it leaves me cold. I'm not watching it anyway, not because of that. I'm not watching it because I find, and people might be surprised to know this, but I find the eating of live animals, live creatures, even bugs, offensive. You know, if I was out in the bush and I had to survive, and believe you me, I could survive, that would not be a problem. But in the name of entertainment, to abuse those animals, quite frankly, I think it's sick and disgusting. And I think if you watch it, well, I presume the people who watch that watch Jeremy Kyle, so we need say no more.
A lot of animals get abused on that show. Thrown in with humans in pits and things. Yeah.
And quite frankly, I'm not sure why Ofcom allow it to continue, but I won't be watching it. So there we are. In fact, I could get quite rude about the whole thing.
Okay, let's move on.
So I won't. I beg your pardon?
Let's move on then.
Are you trying to move me on? Yeah. Why are you trying to move me on?
Because I don't want you to say anything that you'll regret. Not that that'll happen, actually, thinking about it.
Well, no. Yes. You could always cut it out, couldn't you?
I don't cut anything out.
No, that's the problem. Oh, by the way, listen, Christmas is coming. The goose is getting fat, et cetera, and all that sort of stuff. The James Whale shop is open, of course, online for you to get Christmas presents galore. There are signed copies of that fabulous work, Almost a Celebrity, by that fabulous person, Mr. James Whale. There are T-shirts, hats, mugs, anything else?
You can get some audio done for your answering machine, that kind of thing.
Oh yeah, that's a good idea. If you want me to do your answering machine, your telephone answering machine, and even we did discuss this, didn't we? Whilst I'm driving around in the new Ford Cougar, do you know the Ford Cougar I've got at the moment parks itself? It's the scary. I think I've only got it for a few more weeks. It's the scariest thing I have ever done. You just put it into this self-parking mode. All you do is put your foot on the accelerator and it whisks you into a space.
So it's kind of not self-parking then? You have to do it?
Well, I have to press the accelerator, yes.
Well, can't it do it itself?
Well obviously not. But it steers the car and it's got all... It's really strange, really strange. Go and have a little drive of the Ford Cougar with the park assist.
Ah, park assist.
Yeah.
That's not self-parking then.
Well, not right. Okay, it's called park assist, but, you know... But it's quite fun. They've got loads of gadgets on that new Ford Cougar.
Have they got heated seats?
Yep, heated seats.
I've always fancied heated seats.
Yep, no, it burns your bum. Really nice. Oh, back to World Toilet Day.
Okay.
So at least we have that. We have a nice sort of private place to have to go to the toilet. You imagine in Roman times, they used to sit on a long bench all together. I couldn't do that. I couldn't go and sit next to somebody and do it, could you?
No. I could stand and do the number ones, but not the number twos. I can't.
No. Anyway, let's not talk about that. That really. No, let's move on. So, James Whale. Just do the website again. Thought I could hear music in the background. JamesWhaleRadio.co.uk/shop.
That's the one.
Yeah. And whilst you're perusing the website and looking at the new Ford Cougar, by the way, you can also go to Love Film and you can get a month of free movies. Leave it until the beginning of December. Then download it. You get a month free movies for Christmas.
Ideal. Perfect.
It's a brilliant idea. Brilliant idea, isn't it?
Yeah.
And you can also, of course, download copies of audiobooks from Audible. If you're going away, you're driving, there is even an audio version of my own book that you could have me read to you if you wish.
I did that. It's great.
Yeah. Yes. I forgot to charge you for that as well, didn't I?
No, I got it free from Audible.
Oh, yeah. Why don't you go and check that out? Now, listen, we've asked, of course, what you want to hear talked about today, and we'll be doing that towards the end of the programme. And I also put out this thing about, I did an interview earlier, about female priests, female bishops, sorry, not being a religious person myself. And we had quite a lot of response to that. Phil Ward said, my mum and dad were married in 1960 by a woman vicar. I don't think they were, because I don't think you could have women vicars in 1960. And Kathy says, no, just equal rights now for men and women, but some in the church are still against it. They are. I asked this person, actually, they said, it's not in the Bible. You can't have women in positions of authority. It's not in the Bible. Well, I don't know, but I don't think Anglican priests or vicars are in the Bible either. I don't think it mentions vicars, to be honest with you.
I don't think it mentions anything about a church, does it?
No, I don't. So where do these people get all their, you know, I've got very little time for it myself, as you know. Rob says it's all religion to me. And Andy Matty says it'll have serious repercussions on my chess set. Well, that is a serious point.
Yeah.
That is a serious point. Of course, you've got to steer yourself away from talking about bashing the bishop. Pamela says, happy birthday, handsome. What's that going to do with anything? and Mark Cole says, not in my church, I'm a Catholic. Yeah, you say that now, Mark. You just wait. You just wait, mate. And quite frankly, lots of people have been quite entertaining. John Hampson says, yes, long overdue, but when you get clowns like the ex-archbishop saying it's okay for Muslim women to wear the niqab in schools, what hope is there for us? My thoughts on that is, and I believe in live and let live, and if you want to be religious, I think that is absolutely fine. If you want to wear religious clothing, if you think that is good, fine, do it. But I don't think people should be allowed to discriminate against somebody because they don't have a religion. You know, if you want to go around dressed in certain clothes because you think it makes you closer to God, then fine, you go and do that. But don't look down your noses or refuse to have anything to do with those people who believe something different to you. And if people around the world would just take this on board, we wouldn't have the trouble we're having now in the Middle East, probably the trouble we're having in Africa and various other places, even in Eastern Europe, even to a great extent, the problems that were caused in Northern Ireland. We would have less problems if people, you know, we all have, and I don't care who it is and whatever anybody says, in the deeper recesses of your mind, some people it comes more to the forefront, in the deeper recesses of your mind, we all have some kind of belief as to why we're here, where we may or may not be going, and all those sort of things, right? But just let's all just keep it to ourselves. Wouldn't life be easier? And let's not allow religion to be above the law of the land in which we live. And then everybody could exist happily. The thing about Britain is that we are a secular country. Whatever anybody tells you, this is a country where the vast majority of people do not follow some kind of extreme faith where they believe that they are the only ones who knows what's happening. We allow people, hopefully, to follow any faith they want. And if you want to be a woman and be a bishop, then what on earth does it hurt anybody, anyone at all? Okay, I've had enough. Shall we play music? at this point? I think we should. I think we should do a bit of Carol Decker. Why are you not contributing anything to my program today?
I've tried.
Yeah. Where were you?
In what bit?
I don't know. I was waiting for some sort of... Just to know that you're still alive would have been helpful.
No, everything's all working fine. I'm alive. Everything's brilliant. Tickety-boo.
Oh, good. Right. So, time now for us to have some music. And we have an exclusive on the programme. We have got Carol Decker, Tapao, and a track from the first studio album they have made in 16 years. It's called Pleasure and Pain. And this is a track with a title of Nowhere.
Stay!
So listen, that was excellent. Nowhere from Carol Decker and Tapao's new album, Pleasure and Pain. First one in 16 years. If you are a big Tapao fan, you want to get hold of that, go to their website, Tapao, TPAU.co.uk, and you can find out how you can get your hands on a copy of it. Brilliant. Really good. Enjoyed that. Enjoyed that a lot. Enjoyed that an enormous amount. Don't forget, you can follow us on Twitter, of course, at The James Whale Is Me. And, of course, the programme has its own Twitter account, doesn't it?
At James Whale Show.
And you can follow us there as well. And if you want to email me, jameswhaleradio@gmail.com is the email address to get in touch. Check out our website, though. Lots of stuff on there. There's a little video of one of the award ceremonies I did a while ago, a couple of weeks ago now. There's some bits and pieces about Ford's new Cougar, one of our sponsors. And what else have we got up there? Well, we've got old copies of my TV shows and various other things too. Right, shall we move on?
Yeah.
I'd like to do tech talk.
Oh, okay.
Have you not got any tech talk this week?
I've got loads of tech talk. It's just I feel, you know, talking tech is very dull and boring. But I don't know. Maybe they can get in touch and let me know.
I'll be the judge of that.
Okay. Speeding up your computer, the best way of doing it.
Well, that's not boring and dull. That's something we all need to do.
That's why I thought I'd talk about it. The biggest... And the most common question I get asked is, how can I speed up my computer? So.
And?
The best thing that you could do to your computer is replace the hard drive, which is very outdated now. It's like an old record player. It's like a disc that spins round 5,000 times a second and a little head that goes backwards and forwards to get your data off. And it's very slow. And also it's prone to damage, i.e. same as an old record, scratches and so on. So you could lose your data. They brought out a new thing called solid state media, which is basically memory. It's super, super quick. So if you put one of those in your computer and copy all your stuff over, easily 10 times faster than what your computer used to be.
Really?
Yeah.
How much?
250 gig, which is more than adequate for most people, 90 quid.
Really?
Hmm.
Can we get one through James Whale Radio?
We could set up a maybe we should set up a technical shop and sell loads of gear.
Why don't we do that? If you want one of these new things, get in touch with us at jameswhaleradio@gmail.com. And Robbo here, who is a wizard as far as technology is concerned, will be able to find out and maybe get you one at a really good price.
Maybe we could. Maybe we should find a big component retailer and do some deals with them. Yeah.
I think that's a flipping good idea. Right, shall we... I want to talk to my mate Darryn Lyons now, because, listen, if you ever need to be enthused about something, this is a guy... I used to hang out with Darryn a lot. He's a really, really good bloke and upsets lots of people. Maybe that's why I like him. He's not what you would consider to be the normal run-of-the-mill politician, but... He went back to Australia. Now, listen to this. He has got over 1 million followers on Twitter. That's more than my mate Eamon Holmes has. That's more than I've got. He's got 1 million followers on Twitter, this guy. And he is in Australia. Well, listen, let's call him up. Let's talk to him and find out more about it.
Hi, Jimmy Whale. How are you, my friend?
Yeah, very good, man. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm tired. It's been a roller coaster year, and certainly this time of year with the tree and everything else going on down here. It's been a busy year, mate. Tired, but enjoying living back at home, close to mum and dad, and Alyssa being out here now. It's great.
I was trying to think when I last saw you. I think it was when I came round to your office in Clerkenwell, and we were talking about doing a TV show, weren't we?
Yeah, that's right. We were indeed. We were doing a panel. Yeah, no, exactly right. That's right.
And then you decided to go back to Australia. Why?
Oh, look, I think there was a lot of situations that went on at the time, James. I think the global financial crisis was really taking its toll on the business. I think I was running around doing from royal weddings to stuff over in the United States, backward and forward, and I had a CEO in charge of the company at Big Pictures. I mean, I think that the media was hit extremely hard with the News of the World saga, the phone hacking, that went on. And the media business really, I suppose it caught a little bit like mad cow disease. So at the end of the day, I kind of was a situation where the business, I was kind of fed up with it after 25 years in London. Not in London. You never get fed up with London. It's the most wonderful city in the world. But, you know, the media business changed and took a big turn with celebrities. You know, the whole business changed very dramatically, you know, of suing and privacy issues. And, you know, at the end of the day, they took back over control of their publicity. And it certainly hurt the business. And it was time for me to say, really, giddy up and thanks for the memories. Goodbye.
You certainly made a storm when you were over here, Darryn. I mean, people will remember Darryn Lyons is Mr. Paparazzi. He's the guy who appeared on TV. We used to appear together occasionally on Sky News and various other channels with the red Mohican hairstyle and just dressed in a way that people didn't expect unless you were a punk singer.
Yeah, I suppose even as a kid, people call me a bit different. I think I'm just normal because I don't spend my life looking in the mirror like a lot of other people. But at the end of the day, I don't really look at the hair and the clothes. I just wake up and try and feel happy every day, and I dress to make myself happy. So I think at the end of the day, people do have preconceived ideas of Darryn Lyons possibly before they see him. They see the hair and they see the clothes and think, you know, he must be a wanker, but I'm very, very different to that, I would assume. I mean, we met in great circumstances, mate, at Eamon Holmes' wedding, became great mates in London, and, you know, I have total respect for the people I work with for that length of time. I love doing television over in the UK. I just thoroughly enjoyed it.
You're now the mayor of Geelong, is that right?
That's right, a city of Greater Geelong. I am. I am His Worship the Mayor these days, and I came back from the UK, and I have business interests back here, and always have done in Australia. I suppose the situation was it was my fiancée, the lovely Alyssa, who you know, the girl from Putney, and we lived together in Kensington for just on 4 years before we decided to come back to Australia. And I think it was her. I think she said to me, woke up one morning and said to me, yeah, you really should do this thing. You should get a proper job. but I'm a very different character in terms of the political sphere. I've come in and shaken up a situation that really brought it from the trying to drag it from the 16th century to the 21st century. And it's been, it's been hard work, but also the achievements that I've created in my hometown where I was born and bred. I've had a really decisive, and I've got to tell you, it's one of the proudest years of my life in the change that's come about, including, you know, Australia's biggest floating Christmas tree that arrived on the waterfront today with global media attention. So, you know, and that's all about tourism and a 21st century smart city. And we've gone through very bad times, very similar to kind of a Glasgow, a city that had to reinvent itself in tourism and coming out of, you know, Geelong is a similar town with Fords and Alcoa, aluminium makers, big American firms are based here that have now gone and left, and it's a reinvention time. So I took it upon myself, really. I wanted to leave a legacy. I've done well in business over my period of time. I love my home city. Even when I lived in London, I came back regularly. And it's time for me to give back to the people of this great city, and that's what I'm trying to do.
Are you a mayor in the sense that Boris Johnson in London is a mayor, a political mayor, or is it more of a figurehead?
Oh, no, it's very much a political mayor down here. When I say I like the city council to be apolitical, I think that's one thing I have struggled with, the politics within the chamber this year, especially not knowing how local government really, and you know me, James, I go in and like a barrel full of sea monkeys and knock most people over. At the end of the day, I want to get things done and get them done fast. So dealing under a local government act has been difficult. But no, I'm the only one of two directly elected mayors in the country, and I'm actually plonked on top of a group of 12 councillors, and it's a very political council, and it's very hard to control at the end of the day. And I'm elected bigger than any federal seat in Australia here, and so I'm directed over all of the 12 wards, and we have 12 ward councillors that sit under me. But unfortunately, the system, you don't come in on a ticket basis here, which I'd like to see them change it over the coming years. But, without question, it's very political, and I won on a landslide of something around about 68% of the primary vote. So it was a huge win because people wanted someone out of the box and they wanted big change. And I campaigned on vision, passion and change, youth and energy. And, you know, people have been, you know, really, I feel the community is really 100% behind me, although I've got several councillors that want to blow me up on a daily basis, I can tell you.
I want you to come back to London, Darryn, and become London Mayor.
Lord Mayor of London. Boris, well, he'll probably be Prime Minister by then. There might be a vacancy.
Just, I'm going to put a picture of you on the website so people listening to this can see how His Honour, the Mayor of Geelong, dresses. Just describe to our listeners what you look like in your mayoral photograph.
Well, the mayoral robes, I have the most the most gorgeous English rose sitting by my side as the Lady Mayoress now of Geelong. And the Putney girl, Alyssa Lorraine Friday, is really enjoying a role and a charitable role while she's out of here, studying Chinese at Deakin University. And, of course, you'll be impressed. She's studying journalism in her final year here as well, but finishing off 2 years at Roehampton. She's in her final year and transferred to Australia. That's the best part of the picture, mate. The rest is my hair and the mayoral garb, which is the Queen's fur made in Chelsea in, like, 1886. With medals of Queen Victoria, which 1837 actually was the year that solid gold £250,000 chain that I wear around my neck on a regular basis was carved by Queen Victoria herself.
And you have no problems with sporting the bright red or sometimes green or even yellow Mohican hairstyle in the chamber?
Oh, no, absolutely not. I mean, it has become a trademark all around the world, mate. I mean, one thing I will say, James, I probably, with different charities and different days, I think it adapts more to moments in time, whether it be a blue-teal charity or whether it be the Red Cross or whether it be, you know, different days that we have in terms of charitable things these days. But yeah, certainly I mean, the last couple of days, the Melbourne Cup, I was matching the mayors in a purple and leopard print. At the end of the day, it's bringing the focus and the leveraging of the publicity to Geelong and attracting open for business and getting the focus on the city of Greater Geelong as a place to do business and really globally. It's certainly worked here with our ABN's registration in each quarter since I've been mayor have gone up somewhere in the vicinity of 20-30%, with the last quarter registering more than 1,387 new businesses in the city of Greater Geelong. So with a population of about 216,000 people, but it is an area of about 1,200 kilometres square with the best beaches in Australia and the best wine, I might have you say. You'll enjoy that. Although we don't have the best curries, but I'm working on it for you, James.
Well, listen, maybe I can retire over there. Have you got a radio station I can work on?
We have Bay FM and we have K-Rock. I think you're a Bay FM man myself. We're both getting to that age where Bay FM sounds good. And it's great talk radio down here. The Mayoress does a spot every week and I do the occasional laugh with the guys down here. And look, it's a great city and it's a beautiful city. I'm loving being back home. The only issue is, I know you've had your health issues over your time, but, you know, being closer to my mother who went through a whole 12 months of chemotherapy last year, she said to me the other day, I took her to Melbourne to afternoon tea at Parliament House with the Premier, and she said, you know what? She says, when you're in London, Darryn, we saw more of you. You're working, you're that busy these days, back as being mayor of the city of Greater Geelong. So I think Mum wants me to move back to London because at least I came out in for a couple of months a year and we regularly caught up. So that's the job. It's been a very difficult job, but it's one that I get a great deal of pride out of. Although, working in a chamber a difference of opinions as they go, that's what I always loved about your radio show in London, mate. You give as good as you get, and that's what I do as mayor, and it's a very thinking out of the box. I hate to say it, people say, well, you're a politician now. I say, I'm not a politician. Don't put me in that box. I'm just a doer, and I get things done. I'm a builder, and that's what I want to do at the end of the day, and achieve and leave a legacy for my city. But certainly, there isn't a day go past I miss London, that's for sure, and you and Holmes particularly.
How do those professional politicians that you now work with in the two-piece suits and the ties and the shirts, how do they take to being told what to do by you?
Well, it's really interesting. I have a great relationship with the Prime Minister of Australia, Tony Abbott, who actually recently on the TV called me a legend. So you are a legend. So, I mean, I think I don't know that I have a lot more Twitter followers than him. I think that's possibly what it was based off. But look, myself and the Prime Minister have had a great relationship since I've been up to see him in Canberra 6 times. He's been down here a couple of times. So I probably see the Prime Minister as a great ally for the region down here particularly. We have a state election coming up within a fortnight's time, and it's very political time we're going through right now. But look, I think that the government that we certainly have in the moment is a no-nonsense government, and actually bringing about similar change to what I've done to the city. And really, I think the way social networking has gripped the older politician, and the way I won the election, where everyone had their eyes closed, I was up against 16 candidates, and when you win 68-odd% of a vote under 16 candidates, you're doing okay. But I use social media as a great political tool through that time, and I think there's certainly a big wave of how I get to the ratepayers, which I now call customers, which in the public service, they don't like calling ratepayers customers. the whole customer service thing is that they write in and on Twitter and say, well, we've got a pothole in the road, or Mr. Mayor, can you fix this, or can you fix that? And I send it straight to the general managers, which they don't like, and it actually gets done. And so there's been a revelation, and that's why the followers in the region, and I suppose we're a 21st century smart city, and that's what we need to change to, because we've been a very old manufacturing hub city. And look, for 25 years while I was in London, the place hadn't changed a lot. But I'll tell you what, in this 12 months, it's changed a hell of a lot, mate.
Are you going to perhaps eventually set your sights on Parliament there or not?
Oh, look, I think about that on a regular basis. I think it'll be more a decision that Alyssa and I'll make down the track. But, I mean, no doubt I'd love her to be the focus of her career going forward. But there's no doubt that, yes, I mean, I do enjoy making a change in people's lives. But, look, at the end of the day, it is a very difficult job, James, because, I mean, it's really funny to be on the exact... You know, I've been on one side of the camera, then the opposite side as a celebrity. Now I'm on one side of the camera and the opposite side as a politician. So you're having the papers have a crack at you, where I was never on that side. So I suppose the issue really is it's a thankless job, but it actually is a job. You know, for instance, with the Christmas windows I bought in this year in the shops of the city, which was very living on half a lung and very lifeless and going through troubled times. One gentleman came up with his two kids and said, thanks for bringing the magic back, buddy. You really have brought the magic back. It really makes you think that you're doing a good job. So, look, it's a thankless job doing the job, but at the end of the day, I have got a great deal of satisfaction. Have I got sights to be the Prime Minister of Australia? Well, if that is written, well, that would be fantastic. I may be getting a bit old for that at 49, but at the end of the day, look, I've always enjoyed politics, as you know. Have I ever enjoyed the cut thrust of being in it? I'll tell you, 16-hour days and non-stop at the centre of attention isn't necessarily that easy. But you know what? I don't know where it's going to lead, James, but there's no doubt that I'm getting a great deal of personal satisfaction. And every day is a different day in my life, and every day I feel I'm giving back to a community that sadly needed it.
Well, you know, just having not spoken to you for a while, Darryn, I'd forgotten how enthusiastic you can be and how contagious that enthusiasm is. I almost want to get on a plane and come over and live over there with you. I'm wondering whether I can coax you to come back over here, because politics is so dull and so boring and so predictable in this country at the moment. We've got Prime Minister trying to get us into a war, probably get us into a war with the flipping Russians at the moment. I don't know. The world's becoming a smaller place, and politicians, yeah, I'm afraid, have not kept up with the fact we're in the 21st century.
Look, I am absolutely bang on with you there, mate, and that's why I feel I've made a difference and touched a totally different nerve. When I go to a primary school, I get treated like One Direction when I turn up. It is just, you know, and it's because I just speak my mind. And I think we have had politicians for so many years in Britain, in America, in Australia, all around the world, that come out of the university of political correctness. And I am not that. I will speak my mind, and I'm not ashamed, to be honest, and say this is how it is, and this is where I see it. And whether I'm criticised or not, a bit like you on the show, you have an opinion. I think our politicians have lost their form of opinion because, oh my, we might upset Mrs. Jones down the road. Well, I'm sorry, Mrs. Jones may be in the minority at some stage. So I've got to tell you that I think a clear cut where I have come from here and what's been revolutionary is I've engaged a much younger audience in politics that didn't even know that a mayor ever existed in the city of Greater Geelong. And I get principals from schools, private and public, ring up on a regular basis and saying, just thank you, because our kids don't stop talking about our mayor, and they've never been interested in politics in their life. And at the in grade 6 and at the age of 12, I'm not sure I was, but I can assure you a lot of kids in Geelong these days are, because they've got a mayor with, you know, coloured hair and wears different clothes. But, you know, at the end of the day, clothes shouldn't be a race issue, and neither should hair. It's about bringing something different and being honest.
Mind you, you've also got a stunningly good-looking wife, and I've never understood that at all.
Well, I haven't either. I mean, I've got a face like the back of the bus, and I've actually got a head for radio. But there's no doubt about it. She's got everything, and I'm an extremely lucky man. And, look, I think Alyssa has made a huge change, and she's loving Australia. She's not missing the rain. Even in the spring here today, she loved the Melbourne Cup, the Geelong Cup. She's been a huge hit. She sang the national anthem. She's been here not that long and got up in front of 30,000 at the Cup and sang the national anthem, the Aussie national anthem, not the British. And I thought she got a standing ovation. She's done amazing things with charities and all sorts of different charities she's been working with down here, where she was the Queen of Gala Day, which is the Royal Children's Hospital down here, at the weekend in a carriage, and everyone was calling the princess. I thought, Jesus, Kate's going to have a bit of a run for her money. I'm going to have to keep her away from Prince Harry.
You know, the interesting thing, Darryn, is that you would never make it as a politician now in Britain. And that's the sad thing, that there is no way at the moment the establishment can be changed in the way you are doing it in Australia. Why do you think that is?
Oh, look, I think Australia is a country that is it is young in its enthusiasm and craves. I think it craves being a bit different to the rest of the world. And I think that's why it's so progressive. It's why it didn't suffer from the global economic crisis. It's a very young, smart country. I see it in it's a 21st century smart country in terms of technologies, in changing itself and adapting far quicker. I think Britain, certainly I agree with you, has been stuck in the past in a tremendous way. It's opened up its borders and taken people in on a whim and not looking at where really it wants to be in the next century. One thing that I have said in many of speeches since becoming mayor here is we should not be governing for the next term. You've got to go out at an election and you must start to think of the govern for the next 50 years, even if you're not going to be there. You must be setting things up for your sons and daughters and their sons and daughters and their sons and daughters of the future. And that's one thing that Britain did fantastically well in the last century. You look at St. Paul's Cathedral, you look at the visionary planning of the great city of London. Look at where's the visionary acts in Britain today? Certainly the Lord Mayor of London, I think, has done a fantastic job as Lord Mayor. But at the end of the day, what's really changed? Where were the lessons being learnt from greed in the global economic crisis? Where a great Prime Minister we had many years ago in John Howard really actually had a vision to protect Australia from the global economic crisis, where you couldn't go out and get 110% mortgages. You know, you had to have your 30 to 40%. Now, where are the kids in Britain going to be able to afford their first home? They've got no chance at the moment unless they got rich parents.
Listen, I miss you, man. Good to talk to you. And maybe we'll get together one day and do that radio or TV show together we've always talked about.
Well, James, I think the world of you, and I was hoping that you might end up in the jungle, but I know you would never lower yourself. I can't believe Holmes is up the road. I've invited him down to see my Christmas tree on Friday. I'm hoping he's going to turn up. But anyway, look, all the people in London and listening to your show, do me a favour and follow me on Twitter at Geelong underscore Mayor, because you know it's a bit of fun, James, and it's great to talk to you, and I'm feeling like I'm next to you, mate, and I miss you, buddy, and don't worry, we'll have a curry hut for you by the time you get out to this wonderful country.
Mayor of Geelong, Darryn Lyons, thank you very much indeed. It's been a pleasure.
Giddy up. God bless you all.
Would you like a free audiobook? Our friends at Audible are giving everybody a free audiobook just by going to the James Whale Radio Show website, jameswhaleradio.co.uk. All you need to do is click on the Audible link, register, and you'll get your free audiobook. It's a bit like a book club, and remember, you can leave at any time and you still get to keep your free audiobook. So what are you waiting for? Just head over to the James Whale Radio Show website, jameswhaleradio.co.uk, and click on that Audible link now.
I've never really fancied going to Australia, but did he invite me?
He said, come, all expenses paid trip for you and
he
your
did,
producer.
He did, didn't he?
Yeah.
Well, I think we might do that. I think, you know, before the end of the world comes. Actually, I put out a question on Facebook. You can follow us on Facebook, of course, as well. Facebook address, Rob, is...
Facebook.com/James Whale Radio.
Yeah. Oh, did you... Listen, did you hear that story? There's a story today that some people from Essex, I think they were up in Blackpool, I can't remember. But anyway, they'd been staying in a hotel and they didn't like it. It was dirty, it was horrible, it was disgusting. They got home, they went onto one of these sites, you know, one of these social media sites, and posted a really damning review of this hotel. Then they looked at their credit card bill and they realised they'd had £100 over and above what they paid in this whole hotel taken off their credit card. When they got in touch with them, they were told, well, it's in our terms and conditions. If anybody writes anything negative on social networking sites about us, then we charge them £100 as a fine.
Wow, that's a good idea.
Well, I figure if all the people who are rude about me, I can now charge £100, I'm looking at early retirement.
That's an awesome idea.
I don't actually think that's legal, and it's going through the courts at the moment. But, you know, it's like that Gemma, what's her name, who's walked off flipping I'm a Celebrity, as we talked at the beginning of the programme. So, listen, if you're going to be upset about what people say, I mean, within reason, you know, there are some nutcases out there who threaten violence and all sorts. Well, the sooner they're removed and locked up, and people are being locked up now. And remember this, guys, even if you think you can be completely anonymous, my mate Rob here can track you down, and has done on many occasions.
I thought we weren't going to mention things like that on the show.
Oh, slipped out of my mouth. Sorry about that. But anyway, I just charging somebody a fine of £100 if they say something negative about you. It's rather an interesting idea, isn't it? Now, serious point here. I did ask on Facebook, if you were Obama or Cameron, what would you say to Vladimir Putin? Well, because I reckon we're getting a bit too close to not only another Cold War, but also even getting more, a little more violent than that. Because now, back in the day of the Cold War, we didn't have as much on computer. Now, you can, without having to threaten nuclear annihilation or anything like that, you can actually cause a country quite a lot of problems with a cyber attack, can't you?
Yeah, you can shut down all sorts of things, banks, power stations, whatever you like.
And I bet the Russians know exactly how to do it. Lyndon says, can't speak Russian. So, oh, right, okay, so thanks, Lyndon. Mark Brewer says, what we should be saying to Putin is, you win. Carlos says, Cold War number three on its way. Unfortunate thing is, we don't have an army left to defend us. Martin says, I'd rather listen to and trust Putin than that sly dog Obama. Whoops. Eric says, Russia is currently crumbling and many a Russian is moving investments rather rapidly to Britain. I'm not sure about that, actually. Francis Lawton says, Obama and Cameron to Putin, I envy you the way your people support your politics. And to be honest, we're not on the same level as you. God knows we've killed more innocent women and children than you could imagine. And as for the way we treat the weak and poor in our countries, God forgive us. Francis got a sense of humour. Very good. Mark Cole says, the Russian bear was busy snoring its head off until the EU rattled its cage. The EU's dangerous policy of expansionism is not something the UK should be aligning itself to. Interesting thought. Andy says, you're a very naughty boy. Yeah, I think they said that to him. Rudy says, I would revoke Russian passport holders from entering the UK, hoping other European countries would follow suit, hoping the USA would also do the same. This would not only put further pressure on Putin, but would cut the threat of Putin's spies or dodgy band causing a threat to the UK and other EU countries. So all sorts of things. I think my consensus of opinion is Obama, Cameron and Putin should sit around the table and become friends again, don't you think?
Yeah.
Now, we had some questions, didn't we, for me?
Yes, we did. Where are we
then? You've got those, haven't you?
I have. Let me get them.
So this is the bit on the show where if you want to get in touch, you can tweet us, email us or Facebook us during the week of questions that you would like to ask or you would like to hear discussed on the programme. So to conclude this week's show, and by the way, don't forget if you are a new listener, there are 60-odd hours of these shows up there on the website. All you've got to do is download them, listen at your leisure, and give us some feedback. Let us know what you think and where you're listening to us. I know a lot of people listen in America. We've got listeners in Saudi Arabia, Libya. Did you say we had Libyan listeners? We've got listeners in South Africa, all over the world. So welcome. Right, Robbo.
Okay, are we ready? Mark wants to know, has the author Will Self ever taken a photo of himself with his mobile phone?
Yes. Next question.
Okay. Gramsci Pickering, why is there just over 3,500 people died from Ebola and yet 31,000 people have died from freezing death in their own homes? How come we have no charity single for them?
Very good question, and I would refer that question to Bob Geldof and David Cameron. Very good question indeed.
Okay. Simon wants to know, the government's plan to allow British jihadi fighters back into the country.
I didn't know they had a plan to let them back into the country. They have no plans, really, concrete plans, as to what to do with people who have been to another country fighting. As long as they're not threatening us in this country, it would be difficult, because what you would then be saying, anybody who went to fight in another conflict, and there are many people who work in this country as mercenaries, if you were caught doing that and you come back, what the answer to that is, I don't know. I think most of the people who are going to fight in the Middle East are probably not going to make it back anyway.
I thought they were going to ban them for up to 2 years. That was the plan, that they were coming.
Oh, no, they're talking, yeah, but you can't, that's impossible to do.
Yep.
You can't ban somebody who is born and bred in a country from coming into their own country. You're going to lock them up if you can change the law. You can't suddenly ban them from coming back into their country. You know, why would another country want them?
Exactly. Lee Halliday, Miley No Class Moaning.
Well, that just goes to show what an idiot you are, Lee. I watched that piece, and I know, as you know, I know Mylene quite well. I fixed up for Mylene to do a couple of shows on Talk Sport when I worked there. She was absolutely brilliant. Mylene has made some money, of course, and good on her. But Mylene was actually making a very good point, if you'd watched the interview. And I'm afraid poor old Ed just, you know, waffled his way through it. He didn't expect, slightly sexist, I thought, he didn't expect somebody like Mylene to be as sharp-witted and as knowledgeable as she is. She made the point there are lots of people, particularly in and around the southeast of Britain, whose houses are worth over £2 million. Doesn't mean that they're wealthy. It could be an elderly couple who bought the house many years ago and it's gone up in value and are still living on a fairly meagre income, and that would suddenly be hit with this huge extra tax. And why should they be? Why on earth should people who have been successful in their lives have to actually start supporting those people who haven't? I'm not suggesting for one moment that we don't look after the people who are less fortunate than ourselves in society. Of course we should do that. But, you know, suddenly saying I'm going to tax you because you've been successful and your house is worth more than mine, I think personally is probably quite out of order. So I think Mylene has probably proved that she's not just good looking.
Mark Swain, at what point does the government say, that's it, everyone should take a driving test every 5 years? Roads are full of incompetent, uncaring, law-breaking road users. There are far too...
Well, you know what to... Have you finished?
Yes, sorry, I'll...
Yeah, shut up. Mark, you know what to do to improve the standard of driving on Britain's roads, Mark? Are you listening to me, Mark? Do you know what to do? Stay off it, mate. Stay off it. Next.
Carol wants to know, what should she have for dinner tonight? Love your podcast, by the way.
Love you too, Carol. I would have chicken cooked with a little bit of chorizo, maybe some roasted potatoes, and some nice spicy tomato and chili sauce.
Very nice. Andy wants to know, if you had a TARDIS and can go to anywhere and witness anything, but you can't interact, where would you go?
Does he mean what great time in history would I like to see?
Yeah.
Do you know, I don't know. I like to think more of... I'd like to have been around in the Middle Ages and been a knight in armour, but I think the reality of it would probably be quite gruesome. So I'd quite like to go back to the Middle Ages. But do you know what I'd like to do if I had a time machine? I'd like to go forward 500, 1,000 years and see whether we really messed it up or not.
Una says, we need you in Ireland.
Oh, that's nice. You know, I've been in Ireland many times. You know, I worked for a while on a radio station called Atlantic 252, which was based just outside Dublin, and had a great time. And recently was in Belfast anyway, when I was doing a programme called Sunday Morning Live.
Stuart wants to know when we're going to have public callers on our weekly show.
Maybe when we find somebody who's going to sponsor us enough to do some live streaming. It's quite expensive to do that. But, you know, in the meantime, of course, just get in touch this way on Facebook and we'll try and answer as many of your points as we can. If you leave your phone number...
Yeah, that's
when you're asking the question, if you leave your phone number, then we'll call you back and see if we could get you onto the show when we're doing it.
Maybe we could set up an answer phone service and we can play in the messages.
That's a good idea. Hmm. If you'd like that, let's do it. Listen, that's all we've got time for this week. Tell your friends to join us. JamesWellRadio.co.uk. Tweet me your thoughts at the James Whale. And that's about it, really, isn't it?
That's it, yeah. I'm off to go and search for some champagne-coloured toilet seats, I think.
I think you ought to have a word with your wife.
Why?
Well, if she's got you looking for champagne-coloured toilet seats, you need to have words. Take it easy. If you haven't heard some of the other shows, go and listen to those as well. Bye.
Bye-bye.
James Whale, the voice of reason on the James Whale Radio Show.
You're listening to the James Whale Radio Show. For more information, visit www.jameswhaleradio.co.uk. Why not check us out on facebook.com/jameswhaleradioshow or follow James on Twitter @TheJamesWhale. James Whale, the voice of reason.